What was it like having that release schedule and then having it released 1 week after Battlefield 1? Popular wisdom is that crushed you guys. Is that the internal wisdom as well?
I mean, so it's hard because there were a lot of games coming out in the fall, and after the fact, it seems obvious that Battlefield was a juggernaut from their E3 or EA Play announcement. But when you're planning all that ahead, and obviously release dates are set long before you announce your game, it was hard to really figure out which one was going to be the big winner. There was, as you said, the Call of Duty, there's Battlefield, there's a few other games that were coming out. So it seemed perilous no matter what happened. Definitely it was amazing to go to that EA Play with Titanfall 2 and get really excited and then see just that amazing trailer for Battlefield 1. It was kind of a shock for me personally. And it's partially just that DICE does really, really good trailers.
Yeah.
And we didn't have a trailer that was nearly as good for that EA Play.
And so you said, yeah, come play it. Come play it. It plays well, I promise.
Yeah, I think for looking back on it, trying not to wear any kind of rose-tinted or not glasses, and Titanfall 2 had legs. Like, people kept discovering it and kept discovering it, and it goes on sale, or like it went on PS Plus free game late last year. And at this point, like, it's got so many more players than I would have thought given that initial launch. And sure, it didn't make as much money because they weren't all sold at $60 in the launch window and all that kind of stuff, but it found its audience. Like, it has a rabid fan base that is just like, I can't get this anywhere else. And I know what they feel like, because I've been dying for a new Shogo for like 21 years or whatever it is. Like, it's I get it. I think it hurt us in the sense that multiplayer competitive games are a very nearly zero-sum situation to players. If you're not one of the top five most played shooters in the online space, you're a quote-unquote dead game. And that becomes a self-fulfilling prophecy, because players convince their friends not to play. Like, the game's dead. Don't play it. Come play this other thing that everyone else is on with me. Everyone wants to be in the popular crowd. So even though we provided what I felt was a really well-rounded package, and by the time we finished post-launch support, we had a really upgraded Frontier Defense from Titanfall 1. We had done a bunch of really cool stuff, the Monarch Titan and a bunch of game modes and things. It still never had that that collection of people early enough on to maintain its momentum in the online space. And it's interesting because Titanfall was never envisioned to be this competitive esports, like play this game for 10,000 hours type of experience. It was actually like the original Titanfall sales pitch internally was no shooter for old men, meaning we want to make a crazy multiplayer first-person shooter that even if you're not 16 years old, cracked out on Red Bull, you can still have fun and feel like you're a badass. So that's why we made you be able to wall run dump jump. It feels really good, and it doesn't require hardly any skill. The smart pistol makes you feel really great, taken out really quickly. The Titan is basically a really high production value quad damage feel from, you know, it's like, I got to stomp on the squishy guys and blow a bunch of stuff up. Like, it was all meant to be this power fantasy that doesn't require the utmost skill just to have fun. Now, it requires a ton of skill to be really good at it.
Yeah.
But because of that, it's not a game where it's meant to be played for 10,000 hours and you become perfect, perfect, perfect. Our hardcore players are probably screaming right now if they're listening to me, because they're like, what? No, you guys totally didn't understand. It's like, no, you are the outlier. Like, a lot of people got their 20 hours of chaotic fun and then they moved on. And I look at that like, job well done. Like, we gave people exactly what we were trying to give them.
Yeah.
They think that only on it. They like, I vividly remember Gamescom 2013 where public first got their chance to play Titanfall 1. And I would go sit down for an interview after someone, like a press person's session, and all they'd want to do is tell me what they played. Oh, then I ejected, and I was shooting a guy in air, and then I rodeoed a Titan. I'm like, okay, cool, but you got any questions? Like, I know the game. I've played it.
That was cool, wasn't it? Yeah.
So I think from that perspective, Titanfall really hit every possible mark that we set out for it.
And so in the long run, maybe it ended up toppling Battlefield 1 in terms of public sentiment?
Oh, no, Battlefield 1 was a juggernaut.
But like, not sales-wise. Not sales-wise. I'm talking culturally.
Oh, well, it's interesting because you're talking about one in an entry of like 12 of a franchise or however many downloads they've made.
Yeah.
And so I'm sorry, there is sirens going on around me.
That's all right. We had a lot more earlier with John.
So you can do a little RTX enabled tag if you want. But so anyways, go back to Titanfall 2 versus Battlefield. I look at that and a lot of people, like you said, common wisdom is we got crushed, like you know, the game didn't get a proper chance. And I'm like, no, we had millions of people come through our door, play our game, give us the highest user rating of any EA game at the time. The EA, like I said, EA does a lot of market research.
Yeah.
So a certain percentage of players who have opted into these kinds of emails, they get a survey and they are essentially asked really simple questions like, would you recommend this game to a friend? That kind of stuff, like maybe two or three questions. And that gives you a score of sentiment. Is it positive or negative and how much? And Titanfall 2, for the longest time, I actually can tell maybe Apex, had the highest score in that index from any EA game, I think for like 10 or 15 years, since like Mass Effect 2 or something. And so people came in, they played the game for a few hours, you know, 10, 20, 30, 50 hours, and loved it, and left. And like, great, that's exactly what we actually built. And so I don't ascribe to the, oh, we got screwed over by Battlefield or EA or this and that. Like, yeah, we set a launch date. Battlefield pushed a little bit, but not like crazy. They came out a couple weeks later than they anticipated, you know, 18 months before they shipped.
Mm-hmm.
Big deal. It was just not a game that was actually trying to be a 10,000 room for most players.
Interesting.
And that's
Yeah, I mean, I think the lesson that everyone's learned, hopefully since then, is that the way to make your game a 10,000 hour game is to do live service, and you change it constantly and have big seasons dropping and all these big events. That's what you do if you want the game that people play for 2 years. It's not like if we had changed the design a little bit and tweaked some more thing, like ship it and it just would have had this like huge boost behind it and people would have never quit playing. I don't think that's how people play.
Yeah, yeah. And there wasn't a kicking a table going, damn it, EA, why don't you separate these a little bit more?
I mean, it would have been nice, but again, yeah. I don't think it would have changed the equation all that much.
Right, right. MinnMax is a Patreon about games, friends, and getting better. The deepest dive is the best, most thorough discussions about games on the internet. Prove us wrong, please. The MinnMax Show podcast airs every Thursday. Patreon supporters vote on what we stream every single week and a whole lot more. Give us a shot, try subscribing to the YouTube channel, and we hope we can win you over.